All right, we are off and running here. Yes, we are. We have this wonderful ambient background soundtrack of rain. A little bit of rain is coming down. Finally, they keep saying it's going to get here. It's going to get here. Well, a little bit's getting here. There's a lot up north apparently. So we're just going to enjoy this background. And as usual, we have a great video lined up here. And as usual, a flood of insight has taken place since the last video. And practicing the discipline of the wow had to be undertaken, of course. So that's where I'm at. That's where I'm at every day. Either insights or the wow. And it goes back between one of the two. It goes like that. The insights, the wow, then the wow wears off a little bit, and then the more insights, then the wow. And it's just, that's how it goes all the time. Now, the insights had to do with the resistance in this world, or in the tactics of the ego. And very, very powerful insight. And I'm letting it reverberate here. To start off with, we can point out that the prevailing insanity of this world, the one of the main defenses that it's working on and it wants to employ is that, let's say there's some inmates in an insane asylum. The big house. There's a big house, like hospital house, like area, and they live there. Okay. Now, what if they got together? They said, "Hey, you know what?" And they came up with a plan to burn the house down, burn it. And then they said, "Hey, there's no more insane asylum. Therefore, we must not be insane. We must be, that liberates us from being insane because there's no place to go to house us." That means we're liberated from insanity. Now, we might be taken aback by this and say, "Well, what?" And yet, this is how insanity works. It's backwards. And this is literally what's going to take place in this world. Is the inmates are going to burn the world down and thinking that they're therefore free of all their terrible habits, bad habits, because there's no more place to so-called have these habits. It's a crazy, crazy, crazy thing. But this is how insanity works, actually. And I've seen it very carefully and clearly. I'm able to look at it and say, ah, this is the logic they have. Again, someone who's, let's say, in a mental hospital, they say, I'm crazy, but if I'm crazy because I'm in a mental hospital. That's what I think. I'm only in a mental hospital. I'm only crazy because I'm in a hospital for crazies. So if I burn the hospital down and there's no more hospital for crazies, that means I'm not crazy. This is called magical definitional belief, magical thinking. But this is the prevailing underlying belief in this world. And as far as I know, the Holy Spirit keeps indicating this is going to happen. And we must be aware of this ahead of time and recognize it. The mental health professionals, for instance, they got to realize, hey, they're going to burn the hospital down. We better not be there when it gets burned down or sidestep this situation so we can be available to them after they realize that, hey, I still have these bad habits and I still feel threatened and I still... What do you do then? They say, oh, build us another asylum, you know, and another hospital. So we need help, we need help. So they oscillate like that. We need help, but they don't accept the help. This is what I've discovered coming here. They won't accept the help. If there's any evidence of the true light here in this world, at least from my standpoint, the deal is the agreement has to be that the people then have to be quiet, sit still and be quiet, and not ask questions. And this leads to terrible troubles, actually. Sitting quietly, just being still, sitting quietly, is probably the best way to make the fastest progress. Because in full stop in the wow as you're sitting quietly. Because evidence of the true light in itself indicates, oh my gosh, there is a way to get free of all my bad habits. And this is just a shocker. Because we believe there's no way to do it. So we have to resort to these magical solutions that don't work and just cause us so much suffering. And then we realize, hey, I don't have to keep doing that. There's a way. This is extraordinary. So any evidence of the true light in this realm is something extraordinary here. And you cannot bluff. We cannot bluff, which is what, again, those who are suffering from these terrible bad habits, they're bluffers. They bluff and they bluff and they bluff. They say, oh, no, okay, I don't have these bad habits. I can just listen and I can just get it intellectually. This is all a bluff. And you have to call the bluff. And the only the teachers that are, you know, viable teachers, they're the only ones that are able to call the bluff. They know it's all a bluff. It's like people saying, well, if I refuse to admit that I have these bad habits, they don't exist. Or I could just intellectually look at it and say, oh, yeah, I have these bad habits, okay. All right, that's enough. They no longer exist. This is bluffing. This is just silliness. Everybody, with the exception of those who come here to help out, truly help out, who are enlightened, with that one exception, everyone else who believes they're in the electromagnetic universe has extraordinarily bad habits. Habits that are so ingrained that it'll take a lifetime to get free of them. I have to work very diligently and determinedly. These are ancient, ancient bad habits. Deeply ingrained and defended. You cannot do anything about it intellectually, actually. You just flounder and then resort to magical belief. So what the teachers have told us is absolutely true. There's nothing else to say. You just have to keep repeating it. Fundamentally, it's all the same. Great effort is required. Great determination. You must repent. You must change. Recognize. Repent. Says, hey, I got some really terrible habits. They'll stay with me until I get free of them, until I free myself from them. And I can't free myself from them by just ignoring them. And saying they don't that I don't have these bad habits, I don't have any continuity fear, doesn't work that way. We can't outsmart our bad habits. Doesn't work that way. Will never work that way. So all these teachers say is it's a lifelong dedication. And this is. It's the same now as it's always been. We think that we've changed society, we've changed culture, so now somehow that means this issue has been changed. Not at all. We're trying to compensate, saying, hey, we've done this, that means, definitionally, that means that the bad habits don't exist anymore. This is not true. This is, again, just definitional games. Blessmanship. Type of spiritual gamesmanship. And this is what the insane do. Those suffering from severely bad habits, spiritual gamesmanship. Think, and this is what is. This planet is just completely saturated with this. So it's very difficult here to get anybody to actually even start to be quiet, start to experience the wow, and start to be disciplined. Very, very difficult. Even the greatest of teachers don't make much headway here. Because the whole idea of trying to change reality is that we can have these bad habits and ingrain them in ourselves so severely that this ultimately changes reality. We'll get so used to electromagnetism, this pretense, that this getting used to it, getting familiar with it, will then have this transformational change effect on changing reality and making it permanent. So we're trying to make pretense permanent by simply waiting it out. Just extending delay, extend delay, extend delay, extend delay, and we hope this will make it permanent. Now, when we hear it does, it will never make it permanent. We say, "Oh my gosh, I got all these terrible habits, then I got to break." And this is true, but there is a way to do this. This full stop in the wow is ultimately the way to do it. Recognizing the shock. I've used this today a number of times. The shock of recognition was very, very strong. And I started to struggle. I caught myself. Said, "Oh no, that's not full stop. This is not full stop." And had a positive attitude, like, "Okay, great, great." One of the things that's a sure giveaway. You start getting angry at some teacher. You say, "Why didn't you tell me this before?" Or the Holy Spirit, everything. "How come you didn't? It's so easy. How come you didn't tell me this?" That's an immediate sign that you're not full stopping in the wow, and you're struggling with it. We say, "Well, you should have told me that before." Well, guess what? Our whole lives are a string of beads of saying this. Every time the insight arises, we say, "Why didn't you tell me that before?" And we get all angry. And then that short-circuits the whole momentum. Short-circuits the momentum. And we've done this over and over and over and over and over and over. So at some point, this has to be broken. And say, "No, thank you for telling me now. It's a great time. Perfect time. I'll greatly benefit from this." So you have to be really positive, inwardly positive with yourself, and say, "Wow, this is fantastic. Thank you." So once you're able to full stop in the wow with this insight, this insight then becomes your own. It returns home. It's kind of we return home bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, as all our projections return home. Oh, I had a dream a couple of nights ago where all of these cats, that previous cats that had lived with me, they came home. They had passed on. I opened the door, and there's were these cats, and they ran in the house. And they were, I said, "Oh my gosh, my friend such and such and such and such. Oh, you came back. Wow, this is really amazing." And these cats were, you know, really wonderful. We've been blessed with some very, very wonderful cats. A few not so good, but those weren't mine. I'm not taking credit for that. That was quite something. Cats came back from the grave. So this is like our projections coming back from the grave. We think we got rid of them just by having a body die. No, not at all. Not at all. Our habits remain with us, with the mind. The mind is not a derivative of the body. This is such an egregious lie, self-deception. It's the other way around. Just like sickness is actually projected upon the body by the mind, and then for the purpose of trying to treat it, like through surgery or pills or something, thinking that this is a quick fix. In other words, we project a bad habit onto the body and then have it manifest as sickness, and then take a pill, say, "Oh, I knocked my blood pressure down, see, I'm cured, boom, real quick thing." So we're still trying magical solutions like this, because I think these habits, again, we're trying to wait out reality. So we ancient habits, very, very much ingrained, and we believe we can't do anything about them. But that's just our own desire to believe that these habits really have taken root in reality and are working to change it. It's not true. None of them have taken any root in reality whatsoever. And none of them have not an iota of capacity to change reality. So then we think, "Oh my gosh, we're stuck with them." No. No, we can evaporate the continuity fear and recognize we don't need them. So we are not stuck. We are absolutely not stuck. But most believe they are, and then they resort to panicky, magical solutions. And this just goes on and on and on. It's as bad now as it's ever been. Who knows? Maybe even worse. But paradoxically, as soon as we start practicing the silence and the wow, full stop and the wow, our whole path starts smoothing out, and we say, hey, maybe I can do this. I think I can. Might take a while, but I believe I've seen it. And then this triggers another wow. So every time we recognize that we can, maybe we can do it, this triggers a wow. And we have to allow that to subside and don't think, oh, wait a minute, what happened? I lost my confidence. Maybe I can't. No, it's the shock of, positive shock of saying, wow, I can do it. I can see a way to do it. This results in a positive shock, like a psychic shock, positive. And don't try to treat that with pills. Just let it subside naturally. Now, I know I had these insights today, but I can't remember what they were because I'm in the wow, so I don't struggle to try to remember what they were. This is very key. Trust in the process. Trust that you had the insights, and don't struggle to remember them. Don't struggle to remember them. You had them. Once the wow wears off, be easy for them to arise again, and for sure they will. In fact, even better insights will arise. But first, we have to prove that we can handle these insights. If we struggle, it means that we're not handling it properly. We're panicking. So if we just relax, nonchalant, just casually, full stop in the wow, great. Had this wonderful insight, very intense. And so now I'm not going to allow any struggle to take place, either to advance this insight or subtract from it. Keep in mind, if we're trying to advance it, we have to remember what it is. And that's when the struggle starts. So it's a trap. Don't try to advance it in the wow. And if we're retreating, that's certainly counterproductive. We want to know, what are we retreating from? Refuse to entertain that. So neither entertain neither advancement nor retreat. So again, the inmates burn down the asylum and say, hey, we're liberated from our insanity. The inmates burn down the asylum and say, hey, we're now liberated from our insanity. Like criminals say, burn down the prison, say we're no longer criminals. If there's no prison, how can we be a criminal? If there's no asylum, how can we be insane? This is obviously, again, totally upside down, backwards, illogic. And yet, beneath the surface of all these seemingly logical people in the world, this is the logic that is at play. Because the bad, the really terrible habits we have, we just don't believe we can overcome it. So we say, well, this is just a given. There's nothing we can do about it. We need a magical solution then. Some third option that's neither reality nor denial of reality. There is no third option. You know, again, everyone in this world, with rare exceptions, they're believing there's this third option that's not truth, but neither is it a denial of truth. Now, the vision of oneness is not a third option. It's still a denial of truth, but it's a denial of truth put in a way what plausibly infers that truth is true. It's still functioning within perception, just like there's either knowing or perception. There's not a third category. So what we're trying to do with magical solutions is find a third category to escape these habits. Instead of setting them down, instead of owning them, saying no, that. You know, in other words, to separate from our bad habits. So that just keeps the idea of separation going. We say, well, we can't, we try to be separate from God. We've got all these terrible habits. We can't get rid of them. So if we separate from our bad habits, we're separate from God, but also separate from our bad habits, that there's a third category. There isn't any such third category. And yet, almost everyone in the world is seeking for that third category and reinforcing it among all their friends and acquaintances in their lives, that we know it's there. They say, we know it's there, we're working on it, we're almost got it. You know, and so there's this collective belief there's a third option. This is not true. This is why we say mentally ill. Mental illness. Everyone on this planet is very mentally ill, actually. And when you try to come to this world to help them, they think that the only way you can help them is to find this third option for them. And so then they say, oh, you want to help us? You're a mental health professional? You're going to help us? Great. Thank you so much. And they're wonderful. And yet the only thing they have in their mind is they believe that you must be aware there's a third option. You must have found it. And so that you're going to showcase that to them. And ultimately, trying to find the third option is just results in chaos, which is still just perception, appearance. And it's not a third option, actually. And so if you try to help the world and you fall into this trap, you'll end up trying to produce chaos in yourself to try to help others. This is how they see. So they have this belief in what help has to be, which is completely insane. Third option. There isn't any third option. That's why I took refuge from the storm under this tabletop. I was given this tabletop, and it was black and white. There was no third option there. Either it's either truth or it's lies. There's not any third option. Either we accept that, either accept truth or we're not accepting truth. As far as a category is concerned. Whatever truth we accept, that's the truth we accepted. Whatever truth we denied, that's the truth we've denied. Now we can go from one category to the other and say, okay, I'm not going to deny this truth anymore. But that doesn't make a third category, actually. And again, the vision of oneness is not a separate third category. It's not separate from perception. It's simply a reinterpretation, a different purpose given to dreaming. It's still dreaming. So either we're awake or we're dreaming. But we, the world's habit is to insist there's a third category, which is what was really the attempt to separate from the bad habits, the continuity fear. Just separate from it. The way that we think we've separated from God, just say, okay, there's the bad continuity fear there, and there's all these bad habits, but we can disavow that and separate from it. That's the third category. But in the vision of oneness, it's we own it all. We say, no, this is all came from me. It's just habits, that's all. I can change my habits. It's just a dance of plausible inference. I can change the purpose for plausible inference. But I'm not saying that it didn't come from me. Whereas the third category, we're saying we don't know where this came from. These habits, bad, it has nothing to do with us. We're something completely different than that. And it's like trying to separate from the mind. The third belief in the third category is a belief we can separate from the mind. We think we've already separated from God, and now we have this trouble in the mind. So if we separate from the mind, then that'll cure the trouble in the mind. And this is literally what almost everyone in the world believes beneath the surface. Sure, we all play a nice game, surface-wise. Hey, welcome to the new age, you know. I'm cool, I'm hip, I'm spiritually. I've read a couple spiritual books, and yeah, non-dual, that's great. So everybody could talk a good spiritual game, and then but just beneath the surface is this magical thinking, magical belief system, the magic kingdom, really, here. And the belief that we can separate from our mind, which is... projecting these bad habits. It's like saying, well, we can get rid of a projection by just disavowing the mind that's giving rise to the projection. this is obviously doesn't work. It's insane. It's another terrible bad habit. When we talk about terrible bad habits, that's one, isn't it? Oh, is the mind causing problems? Okay, just separate from the mind. Fixed. And we think these humans, yeah, these humans are very advanced in separating from the mind, human body. We take refuge in the body because the body doesn't seem to be, it seems to be separate from the mind because it's actually just a puppet, just a projection. But it's not separate from the mind, actually. Nothing is outside or separate from the mind. But the body is sort of our chosen projection to try and believe this. We think, no, it's just the brain, see. We've managed to separate from the mind. Now we're just a human with a brain. And we don't have these bad habits anymore. It's just an ancient memory. And once we fully identify with our humanness, then we're saved. This is called humanism. It's completely insane. That's what the belief is. That once we fully identify with our body and our humanness, our human nature, our body and the world, then we're saved. From the mind, from all these bad habits of the mind, projection, everything. Humanism, secular humanism, this is what it is all, that's what it's saying, that's what it believes in. So, good luck trying to reach these people. I wasn't able to. There's very few are able to come in this world and not fall in this trap of trying to be a master of this third option, because this is what the world, again, virtually everyone in this world, anyone who needs any help, they think the answer is separate from the mind, identify with the body. Identify with the body, they think that cures the issue. And they say that once the body dies, well, that's a permanent cure. no more troubles. No more troubles for who? I mean, they'll say, well, there's nobody there to have any troubles. That's what they're hoping. Magical belief. They say, well, when nothing exists, how can anything have any problems or have a continuity problem? And they can mix this verbiage up in non-dual, various non-dual ways to sound really spiritually hip, but that doesn't change the bad habits at all. So we need to focus on recognizing our bad habits. Say, ah, I see this. Great. So I'm not as trapped as I thought. It was just a strategy, an ill-advised strategy that I've been using that's bringing about this suffering. Great. And then the wow will start arising, and you expect it, and you say, okay, great. And I've had the insight. Let's now accept the wow, accept the backlash from that. It's like you hit a home run in baseball. Boom, home run. Well, guess what? You got to trot around the bases and have everybody cheer you. Or if you're in a way ballpark, everybody boo you. I mean, that's the price you pay for hitting a home run. The wow. Everyone's going, wow, did you see that? Wow, wow, wow. The stands in there cheering, screaming, and your teammates are going, wow, that's great. You got to circle the bases and high five, high five, high five, and you know, hey, all right, hey, everybody slapping you on the head. Way to go, man, way to go. And that's the price you pay to be a home run hitter. So we have to be home run hitters. And, you know, you jog around the bases, and high five, and that's how it goes. So the wow arises, and we just have to put up with it. Part of the price of doing business. But those who believe in magical solutions, they're always looking for an opportunity. So maybe the magic will work this time. Maybe it'll work this time. And they just ceaselessly keep doing the same thing over and over, which doesn't work. It's called insanity, is doing the same thing over and over, believing you get a different result. They don't ever get a different result. And yet they just, it's like, sort of like on autopilot, just keep trying it, keep trying over and over and over and over and over. Hoping that by being identifying with the body, this resolves the the troubles, the inner troubles of mind. That mind is the threat that mind feels from continuity threat. I mean, this electromagnetic universe is just a pretense, and so mind says, "Oh my gosh, this is very threatening. What happens if it just disappeared? The universe disappeared. Oh my gosh, how could I function? I'm too scared." And so then it tries to insist that it's either not, that it's not a pretense, it's real, or if it can't quite assert that, it says, "Well, I'll just detach from this electromagnetic universe too. I'll separate from that one and make another one, make another." And that'll solve it. No, it's still the light. Whatever arises is the light. So even if you made it, even if we made another separate universe, something, some situation separate from this universe that we appeared to be separate to us in mirage-like way, it would still be 100% from the pure light, and the light would still be 100% pure. So the threat to the loss of pretense would still be there. To the vanishment of pretense, it would still be there. And we have made, like, dimensions, each realms and dimensions, trying to separate like this. And there could be some realm, more hellish realms, they claim, or that there's hellish realms, which are even worse than this one. All attempts to do the same thing. And thinking, if I just go deep enough into this separation, eventually it'll work. And this is why we tend to spiral down into severe depression and severe overt mental illness, because the covert mental illness is just at work, at play, and then it shows up in the body, projected upon the body. Then we say, aha! There's the culprit. There's the villain. It's the body's fault. So at least I've been able to identify a lot of factors around my own troubles in terms of trying to help out. People would say, "Well, oh, you're here. You know truth. Oh, great." They thought I'd found the third option, because they think that's the only way. Of course, that it's unthinkable here that we can actually get free of these bad habits by owning them and gradually evaporating the continuity fear. But again, nobody hardly here thinks in terms of a lifelong ever. They say, "Well, can I do it in a day or two? Maybe a weekend retreat? If I can't do that, well then forget it. It's impossible." What is that? I can't do it for several days. It must not work. That's why monastic culture is so much better, is the culture accepts it as a lifelong endeavor. Whereas here, we're about as far away from monasticism as it's possible to get, just about. Where we'd say, well, that'd be a couple 2-day retreat, should be able to get it. We have teachers advertising, those that say they're teachers, and say, I can transmit the truth to you, just just in one, you know, in an hour sitting. You don't even need a weekend. And that's it. You're liberated. And that appeals to us because it appeals to the magical belief in separation, because we think, well, that must be what we can do then, separate from it. Because they, at some level they realize, well, that's ridiculous because these habits are so ingrained, but if we just separate from the habits, then deny authorship of them, that they just were produced by something outside of ourselves that we don't know what it is, that seems like the quicker way. So here we deny that light has any problem. We say light doesn't have any problem whatsoever. We are light. Light has no problem. Again, so if evidence of light, I was asking for evidence of light here, let's give evidence. Well, how are people going to react to it here? Well, if they're not willing to take up the challenge, then they'll react like, oh, this is a third option. It's a separation option. And of course it's not. And then they'll start asking all the questions and they'll seem to be interested in it. But very quickly it gets into extremely problematic. It's problematic from the very beginning. So any evidence of light here needs to be met with positive silence, positive attention, but quiet attention, positive quiet attention, not asking questions. Light provides plenty of help, plenty of food, spiritual food to digest. It's like there's a huge meal and the people are sitting around talking instead of actually starting to eat the meal. The challenge is to eat the meal. How are we going to eat that meal? It has to be eaten. I say, well, I better do a little bit at a time, bit at a time here, and but if we sit around talking, bragging, ah, yeah, I'm gonna eat that meal. This is great. I'm gonna eat that meal. And now, what's it like after we finish the meal? And da da da. Never get around to actually eating it. This is bluff. The people who were so mortified by our bad habits, we think we can never do anything about it, that we think that we just have to bluff our way, that we actually have the bad habits, but somehow convince God, hey God, make me happy too. I can't get rid of the habits. I'll have those also, but you have to find some way to make me happy, even though I'm keeping all the bad habits. There isn't any way to do that. And yet people will ask questions ceaselessly about this, like this way. It's all the same question. It's just basically, well, how do you do it? Do it this way? And they say, well, you can't do it. Well, you mean I can't do it this way? So they keep asking specifics to avoid the overall generalized realization that there isn't any such way to do it. This is the problem with question asking, is going to specifics. Well, like magical belief, what do you think about this form of magical belief? Can I do it this way with magical belief? And they say, no, you cannot. They say, ah, okay, I've made a lot of progress. I realize that this way of magical belief doesn't work. That means that's helped my search to find. I've eliminated one form of magical belief, until now I only need to search among these forms to find the right one. All right, this is what happens. Then they ask more specific questions, more specific, and they say, "Oh, you're helping me so much, Tisha. It's great. I have like 10 different types of magical habits you've shown me that don't work. That means it's narrowed my search down, and I'm thinking it now is probably it's this one or that one that works." Completely not hearing that no magical belief works. That's what we don't want to hear here, these absolutes. So we keep dealing in specifics to avoid the absolute. It's a game. It's a trick. That's why it's better to be quiet and let the generalization dawn that we're talking about. You know, never, none, impossible, absolute. It encompasses all magical belief, no matter what, no matter how what form or strategy it may take. It could, infinite forms and strategies, it doesn't make any difference at all. None of them have the slightest possibility of ever working. So there's no need to evaluate them specifically one by one by one. That's just a clever egoic game wrapped in spiritual garb. As soon as we start asking questions, it tends to go towards specifics, right? It lends itself, the inference does. One moment here. And we don't realize that projecting everything on the body, those are all magical beliefs. And then treating the body, thinking, okay, this is working. See, it matters to separate from the mind. And then there's a way then to make the body healthy. That means I have a healthy mind. This is endemic here. This world here is a total insane asylum. That's why it's so difficult for teachers to come here and help. Even the greatest teachers don't make much headway. It may seem that they have historically, but a lot of it is distortion by the egoic distortion, and goes right back into magical beliefs. And then we think, oh yeah, look at this great tradition, and there's so much headway. But really, what the teacher came to teach, the ego just kept bluffing and assuming that there was some magical belief that works, and that they've discovered it. And you just have to keep on believing in it until you die. And when you die, who cares whether it's right or wrong, you know? It's just like that. It's just like this temporary hope, well, it might be right, and then when I die, body dies, I'll never know whether it was right or not. So at least gives the plausibility that it could, because just any evaluation of it is going to end with the death of the body. So, hilarious that we're using the body. What time is it? It's 3. Okay. Still not reading strongly at all, just a little bit. This is ridiculous. It's supposed to. These difficulties make it difficult for anybody to come here and teach. It really does. So if there is evidence of the true light, at least the light in a non-pretense mode, understanding that pretense doesn't come from the light itself, came from spirit desiring that this light to change itself. Light in the non-pretense way, natural, true light, non-pretense, unpretended, unpretense, devoid of pretense. Any appearance of that in this world, any evidence of it, evidence, our job is to be quiet. Not ignore it. I didn't say ignore. That's different, right? That's magical belief. I just ignore it. This will prove that I'm separate from the mind. This is what happens. Some proof comes in, everyone ignores it. They say, well, we're working on proof. I'm just proving that I am the body, and therefore I am separate from the mind. Therefore, this has nothing, has any effect on me at all. This is what most do. There's so many different ways of trying to deny it, defenses. But if it arises, then just be quiet. Positive awareness of it. Positive interest, positive focus, positive intensity. But don't get into specifics. Don't let your mind start jumping into specifics. And again, verbiage. The way that it plausibly suggests and infers that we're speaking about specifics and not something that's true in all cases. It infers an exception. Language is built out of the belief in exception to truth. It arose out of this attempt to say that truth isn't true. All truth isn't true. So now, why can a teacher talk? Because they're aware of all this, and they don't get trapped in it. But those who have not done the work inevitably get trapped in their words, and then they start going to a psych out thing about level confusion, and it's bad, really bad. And then they think, oh, I'm not cut out for this. It's too difficult. Now, the teachers know this. They say, just if you want to make real fast progress, just be quiet. Don't say anything. But not in a detached way, like ignoring again, but positive attention, intensity, great intensity, but full stop in the wow. Don't allow yourself to start going down the road of specificity, because that's where the bad habits will start grabbing. They've laid out all these traps. And our bad habits are so bad that we get pulled down by them. Now they might see a teacher and say, "Oh, the teacher's not being bothered. He's just happy. That means the world must be treating them well, or this third option they must have found it." So I want to find it. I want to be a teacher too, and they try to act like they're a teacher, and with verbiage, and this then trips them up badly. They're not willing to put in a lifetime of effort to break these bad habits. Not willing to break the bad habits. I keep saying, well, if I'm a teacher, that means I don't have bad habits. So let me just act like a teacher and then I won't have bad habits. That's insane too, right? It's like someone who's suffering from severe insanity, and they tear all their clothes to shreds, or something. It's just a symptom of it, and they see these respectable people who, on the outside, with the nice suits and ties and walking, you know, whatever, and they think, hey, if I just put on a suit and a tie, I won't be insane anymore.
They're walking around, and I'm in a suit and a tie, I'm in a suit and a tie, I'm all dressed up like this. And
so everyone has this some shtick about some trick, some strategy, a whole line of strategy. Everybody has that. We all have terrible habits. So it's way better to simply realize that these, we can get free of these bad habits, and then be quiet about the realizations, full stop in the wow, because this is what really helps us, motivates us. And just evidence of the true light, the non-pretense light in this world, we say, oh my gosh, it hasn't forgot about us. Maybe it hasn't changed. Maybe we can't. It's a very profound shock. And ultimately, the more familiar we get with this, the easier our habits dissolve. Because the continuity fear gets less and less, and then we say, oh, I don't need to. I really don't need that habit. And some practicing of just not going there, you know, it's very helpful. I don't need to go there, so I'm not going there. And this was what really dissolves the habits, you know, quickly, fairly quickly. Okay, well, I just wanted to get this video in here, and I've been able to do that. Had an hour time. I said, let me go for it. Let me do this. It's very much worth to keep hearing this, because again, the inmates plan to burn down the asylum, thinking that's going to liberate them from insanity. Literally. This is how they think. This is their logic. And they see no other way out. They don't see any other way out. They think this is it. They say, the body's the one that's got all the problems. That's the problem. Destroy the body. The world's the one with all the problems. Destroy the world. And then we won't have any more problems. Remember, we made the world and bodies in order to project upon our problems upon. If we try to get rid of it that way, we'll just make another world and more bodies and project upon them. It doesn't solve anything. And yet they are, this is what they're planned to do. Burn the asylum down. Now the asylum is helpful. It's helpful actually. Because it gives us an opportunity, reflection of what we're doing. We can look, oh, I'm projecting on the body. Oh, I'm trying to treat the body in this way. Oh, you know, I'm projecting this world. Oh, you know, why am I doing this? So it's a reflection. It's kind of like the insane look in the mirror and say, oh, I don't like what I see in the mirror. It's terrible. So they break the mirror, smash the mirror. They say, oh, problem solved. Instead, realizing, no, we're projecting. Everything we see, we're projecting upon the mirror. So project something different on the mirror. The plausible inference that reality is real, project that onto a mirror. You know, don't blame the mirror because it's cloudy. Don't say, oh, it's all hazy and cloudy. There's something wrong with the mirror, and smash the mirror. we're getting a faithful representation of what we're projecting. Always we do, light is faithful to us, absolutely. You cannot change what it is. So we cannot, don't smash the mirror. That's not the way. If you got to make an hideous face in the mirror, don't say, oh, look at that horrible hideous face, let me smash the mirror. And yet this is what is planned here. This is what the insanity here, it you know, the civilization, the civilness here is superficial. It's not really a spiritual culture. And beneath the surface is this belief that, aha, we found the answer, we're just going to burn the place down. And of course in the Bible it does say that the world is not going to be destroyed by water but by fire. The final end of the cycle is going to be destroyed by fire. Interesting. An asteroid would certainly do that. If it set up enough debris, and that coming back down would be like fireballs everywhere, just lighting, you know, setting everything on fire, nature on fire, just be fires, along with superheated atmosphere. If it was a big enough asteroid, it would superheat the atmosphere coming in, which would cause this blast of superheated air to spread out and just, you know, incinerate everything. I mean, yeah, just ask the dinosaurs. They didn't have much fun with it. Didn't have much luck with it. So, there's nothing outside of the mind. So the mind is active, making these projections and trying to get free of its troubles by trying to destroy itself or separate from the mind. And crazy, crazy strategies. And yet these strategies continue on until we're truly have gone to the right path of gradually path of familiarity with truth. Evaporating our continuity fear. Unless we've done that, we'll continue on with these crazy strategies. There's no way around it. Magical belief, there's always crazy strategies, all sorts of them. We'll continue on with them, and the misery that those bring, and the frustration, and the anger. It says, how come this didn't work? And we think we just get angry enough, it'll work. So we get very, very angry and furious, and sometimes whole civilizations get very angry and furious, it hasn't worked, and they attack others, project that, and attack others, and big, huge wars break out. It goes on and on and on and on. This is not all just happenstance of chance, circumstance. No, it's all exactly, follows exactly from the mental dynamics of these terrible bad habits we have in magical belief. It absolutely comes from that, 100%. There's no such thing as just, well, it just happened, circumstance just happened, we have no idea why it happened, and no, it's not like that at all. Well, just a bad person, it was a bad person did it, and a bad human. No, that's not it. So ultimately, we eventually get so tired of this. We decide, like, this, I've got to find out the truth, and then just practice being quiet and considering truth, being quiet. Don't try to outsmart it. When you're just quiet as much as possible in the mind, then all these questions don't arise. So many questions are answered simply by not asking them. Because you start getting to the general truth that, you know, all lies are lies. All magical belief is equally futile, doesn't work. You don't have to specify. You go more and more and more to abstraction and not realizing that you don't need to really ultimately specify. All illusions are equally untrue. So the more we go in that direction, the closer we get to mental health, true mental health. And the more we're projecting, specifying, blaming, thinking, oh, this has helped me out, the more we're just exacerbating mental illness. Not that the mind is literally sick, but you know, bad habits, bad tactics, bad strategy. Doesn't work. Futility. It's got a nice little beat going here. Got the drummer in the background there. Thump, 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 thump. It's like super improvisational jazz here. So today really is miserable. Yesterday was supposed to be and it wasn't, but the misery did come. So yeah, they were saying, okay, rain's coming, rain's coming, rain's coming. Well, we knew it was going to come eventually, and now it's here. We had a little time to, you know, a little grace period there. So we're having this little grace period in the world, but the strategy of insanity is always bad news. Project the problems on the body, destroy the body, we're saved.
That's right. That's what they think.
Project all the problems on the scapegoat, like Jesus, destroy the scapegoat, we're saved. This is magical belief. Magical belief. Mental illness. Very bad mental habits. And they think they just have to celebrate then, and just keep celebrating that and saying it'll make it true. No. So just be quiet, be still, be quiet. Full stop on the wow. And so I need to get going here. But again, continually reinforce, because the grace period is about over in terms of the insane are about ready to burn down the asylum, believing that will liberate them from their insanity. And we know that that certainly doesn't work that way. So we are getting there, step by step by step. We're getting there. Just recognize it and just, wow, I just recognize this, wow. Nothing, you don't need to do anything about it. Just to get used to it. Get used to the recognition. Just get used to it. Just saying this is like natural to me as breathing. I don't have to respond a bunch of words or anything. No, this is an intrinsic truth here. This is not some projected thing I need to grasp outside of me. This is intrinsic truth here. So just simply, wow, yeah. This is the true light is still the true light. The one light is still the one light. Nothing's happened to it. And these are just echoes of this truth. Faint echoes maybe, but echoes. And we feel that this echoing of the truth, and then we accept it like, wow, I accept this is true. But let me just get used to this. We can handle stronger and stronger echoes, stronger and stronger stronger and stronger echoes. This is the path. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.